Everyone is here. We're going to get started here in just a minute. We still have several people logging on. So we are here in our living room practicing the social distancing. I'm going to mute my phone so that I am not having mine. There we go. Welcome, everybody. Good to see Jennifer with us. Hey, Jennifer.
Hey, Jennifer.
Good to see everybody logging on. We're going to get started here in just a minute. All right. Well, good morning. Welcome to worship. This is our second worship service online only. We are streaming from our living room. We're all practicing the social distancing like we're supposed to. We're trying to figure this out, and we're hoping that this can be a time when we can reconnect with one another. Even if it's just through a screen, at least we can sing together, hear a message as together we worship. I don't know about you, but I've been wrestling with a whole bunch of emotions, and so I just want to this morning live into those emotions and also just continue to grasp to the hope we have in Christ. Let me open us up in prayer. We'll sing a few songs, read some scripture, hear a message as we continue to worship. Pray with me. Gracious and loving God, you are with us. Lord, speak to us. Stir our hearts. May we be reminded that we are your children, that we are loved by you, and even in the midst of these trials, you give us the greatest gift of peace and grace. Lord, continue to be with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Good morning, Outpost. I so miss all seeing all of you guys' faces. This is kind of a newer song. If you want to look up the lyrics, it's called All My Fountains. Let's get worshiping. This dry and desert land, I tell myself keep walking on. Here's something up ahead, water falling like a song. An everlasting stream, your river carries me home. Let it flow, let it flow. All my a flood for my soul, a well that never will run dry. I've rambled on my own, never believing I would find an everlasting stream. Your river carries me home. Let it flow, let it flow. My fountain. Awesome. I wish I could hear y'all's voices. If y'all have a second, why don't y'all send each other a little greeting text? We can still have our shake and bake even virtually. Hello. Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, He is my song. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, He is my song. You are good, You're good. Your prayer this morning. I know it feels pretty hopeless and it feels very lonely sitting in your houses right now, but we have to know that even in the middle of all this, that He's never going to let us down. He's got a plan. You're never going to let, You're never going to let me down. You're never going to let, You're never going to let me down. You're never gonna let, You're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, You're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, You're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, You're never gonna let me down. Good. Oh, Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this morning. In the midst of all of the chaos in the world and when we think that things are bad, help us to remember, Lord, that you are very, very good. Lord, I pray that as we're listening in at home this morning, I pray that you open our hearts and our spirits to what it is that you want us to hear. Because even though we're in isolation from each other, we are not in isolation from you, because you cannot be hidden. In your son's name, amen.
Amen. So this Lent, as we travel through the wilderness, we have been doing a series called The Walk. And, you know, times are pretty chaotic right now, as Abby just prayed about. And so continuing in the series just didn't really feel right to me. And so this week and last week, I've been praying and been wondering what to preach on, right? How, these are unprecedented times. It's chaotic. We're sort of all in our own living rooms. We've been asked to stay away from each other, to distance ourselves from each other, which is the exact opposite of what the church is about. And then I remembered about a year ago, I was in a Bible study where we studied 1 Peter. And 1 Peter is written to a group that has been dispersed. You see, it's written from Rome, but it's sent to regions around Rome. People who, well, feel isolated, who feel like they are disconnected from Rome, from the center of where everyone is. And as I began to read 1 Peter, here's what I read. And so if you have your Bible, I want to invite you to open it. 1 Peter, it's at the end of the New Testament. 1 Peter chapter 1, this is how it begins. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the exiles of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, who have been chosen and destined by God the Father and sanctified by the Holy Spirit to be obedient to Jesus Christ and to be sprinkled with his blood. May grace and peace be yours in abundance. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold, that, though perishable, is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy. For you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Let us pray. Loving God, you indeed are our rock and our redeemers. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing to you. Amen. So I don't know about you, but I've sort of ran the whole gamut of emotions. I've been anxious this week, and then I get anxious about my anxiety, right? I'm disappointed. And then there's times that I get disappointed that I'm disappointed. I'm angry and frustrated. All the emotions of being separated from others. I don't know about you, but I've gone through all of those emotions. And it's made me kind of think about other times when I've been isolated, when I've not quite fit in. Sort of a light story now, but looking back, when it actually happened, it was quite devastating. Perhaps there's no more awkward time than middle school. I was in eighth grade. It was the summer before my eighth grade year, and the girl that I really liked asked me to go to a concert. It was a concert at Six Flags. It was back when they used to have concerts at Six Flags, and I didn't even know what the band, who the band was. It didn't matter, right? She asked me to go to the concert, and I was all in. And so as I found out more about it, I realized that I was going to a concert. I was going to a New Kids on the Block concert. The original boy band. And so here we are, we're in the concert, the whole crowd is going crazy, we're singing songs, Hanging Tough, Step by Step, all the really great, rich songs of New Kids on the Block. And I didn't know very many of the words, but fortunately, once you've heard them, they're very easy to sing along. And so I fit right in, and I did what everybody does at a concert. I got the t-shirt. And so I got the New Kids on the Block t-shirt, and man, I'm a fan of New Kids on the Block. Well, the summer went by, and my family and I, we'd gone up to Wisconsin. I'd been away from my friends, and we'd visited my grandparents in Wisconsin for about a month. And so first day of school rolls around, and what do? The first day of school, you wear your favorite shirt. You wear your shirt. And so it was easy for me, right? I'm going to wear my New Kids on the Block t-shirt the first day of school. What I didn't realize is that even though their song Hangin' Tough was a hit, they faded as quickly as they rose. And so that first day of school, people began to laugh at me. And what are you wearing? New Kids on the Block. Nobody likes New Kids on the Block anymore. And I was devastated. Have you ever felt isolated? Perhaps that question is a little bit too on the nose. But have you ever felt like you just didn't quite fit in? Peter writes a letter to the churches. To the churches that are in dispersion, the diaspora, the ones that have been scattered around, the ones who are trying to live by faith, but are realizing very quickly that they just don't fit in. They're trying to figure out, how do we let go of an old world that we used to know, that world that was so familiar, and how to live into this new world that has been given birth by Jesus Christ? How do we let go of the old and experience the new life that Christ is calling us into? It is a very live question, because they are stuck in a culture that rejects them, that is persecuting them, a culture that is very hard. yet they're trying to figure out what faith looks like. Another way of putting it, they're trying to have one foot in this world and one foot in the kingdom of God, the new kingdom that God is continually opening their eyes to. It's a struggle to let go of that which we have known and loved and accepted and bravely walk into a new world, a new reality, an entirely new kingdom. One theologian, Stanley Hauerwas, calls them resident aliens. That is, they're residents in this world, but they are aliens because their ultimate identity is from another kingdom, the kingdom of God. I want you to notice how Peter begins his letter. It's the way so many letters begin, whether it's Paul or others. He begins with two very powerful words, grace and peace. I write to you, and may the grace and peace be with you. It's two words that we often use, grace. We sing Amazing Grace. Hear the lyrics. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace that brought me safe this far, and grace will lead me home. A grace that is both undeniable and indescribable. A grace that is an unmerited favor, a continual love of God, a gift that meets us at every point in our lives. Grace. Grace and peace. Peace be with you. A peace that is not a peace that's only found when times are easy, but a peace, a shalom that is always present. Perhaps you sign your emails, peace be with you. We call it here at Outpost, a shake and bake time, a passing of the peace, a peace that spreads among the community, a peace that is a gift from God that meets us exactly where we are. A peace that is not absent of affliction, but actually comes to us even in the middle of our greatest trials. Peace be with you. Peter begins with this because it is the foundation of his letter. It is the foundation of what he wants people to know. Grace and peace be with you. And then notice the word he moves to. He moves to the word hope. Hope. Hope that is rooted in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Hope. Hope that today will not last forever. Hope that life conquers death. Hope that even in our darkest moments, there is always light. He roots this hope in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He reminds people that this new world is defined by new birth. new birth that goes through the death of the old, the death of that which we cling to, and move into a resurrected life. The way that gold is purified, it is tested by fire, it goes through a purification process in which all the stuff that tries to cling to the gold is removed so that it is pure. And yet Peter reminds the people there are some things that are even more precious than gold. Perhaps you have discovered those things this last week. The times with our families, the hearing the encouragement word from others, the solidarity that even though we are separated physically, we are together in this. We got this. Because the gift of God, the grace, peace, and hope, the gifts of God are always eternal and unfading and imperishable. They stand the test of adversity, of trials, of suffering. Peter reminds us that our hope is rooted in the new life of Christ, the resurrected Christ. And then he ends with, as we move through this, we are working out our salvation. Our salvation is coming. There is a sense in which we are saved, we are being saved, and we will be saved. It is the promise that Peter reminds us of. God's ultimate act is one of healing and salvation. And so, as we wrestle with the different emotions, as we go through life, this new world that we are entering into, may we be reminded we always have one foot in this world and one foot in the kingdom of God. That God is always calling us to be resident aliens, that is, residents of this world, ready to let go of the old, to let that which has to die, so that we can live into a new world, a new life, a new birth that is always rooted in the hope that life follows death, rooted in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. At Outpost, we have proclamation and then response. I want to invite you. I know some of you are in a place financially where you cannot give, and we completely understand that. I know many of you are also remaining faithful in your giving and your tithes and are in a place where you can give. I want to thank you for that. Thank you for your gifts. You can click on a link in the comments to give online. You can set up a bill pay, and you can also mail a check to the church. I want to thank you for your gifts. So many of you have given sacrificially through this time, and so thank you. We also respond through communion. I want to invite you to go to your pantry if you haven't already. This is something we're going to continue to do, where we're going to have communion. And so I invite you to grab a piece of bread, a cracker, anything that's similar to that, and also some juice. It can be grape juice, it can be whatever, some kind of juice. The point isn't the exact bread and grape juice. The point is this. Jesus took ordinary things, things that they ate and drank daily, and he does work through it. He takes bread. He gives thanks for the bread. He blesses it, and he said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Whenever you eat of this, know that you are the body of Christ." And when the supper was over, he took a cup. He gave thanks for the cup. He blessed it, and he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant. This is new life. In this cup is salvation. And whenever you eat from my body and whenever you drink from this cup, know that you are the body of Christ, redeemed by my blood." Holy Spirit, descend upon these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. Make us one with you, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, as we continue to feast at your heavenly banquet, at your table, until you come in final victory. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we who are many become one. The sharing in the body of Christ is the sharing in the brokenness of Christ. And in the same way, because there is one cup, we who are many in our many different places become one. A drinking from this cup is a drinking of the life of Christ, the very salvation of God. And so now at this time, I invite you around your tables, in your kitchen or your living room or wherever you are, to serve each other communion. The words you may choose to say as you give the bread, you can say, "This is the bread of heaven, the gift of life." And as you distribute the cup, you can say, "This is the blood of Christ shed for you," or perhaps you may want to say, "This is the cup of salvation given for you." I invite you to receive the gift of bread and the cup. This is the bread of heaven, the gift of life. This is the bread of heaven, the gift of life. This is the bread of heaven, the gift of life.
sang this song last week. It was kind of a new one. If you want to look up the lyrics, it's called A Living Hope. It just came out this year.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross is spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my
received the first devotion through email last week. We're going to be sending out additional devotions. We're also trying to set up a a time when we can get together over Zoom and have some conversation around the next devotion. So be on the lookout for that. Also, Renee has some exciting things for our kids to do as we're parent teachers through this time. We can have some activities and have some things for the kids. Please, if you are not part of our email group, email the church. You can find that on the website, and we'll make sure to add you to the list, and then you'll be up to date on anything. Of course, we'll be updating on Facebook and other social media. So thank you for worshiping. May the grace and peace of Christ be with you now and always.